After my daily chores, I have been going out to check on the bees. Automation of the hives has been my priority, to gather as much honey and other things from them as I can. The bees seem to be settling into the area nicely, and the queens find the hive a good place for the drones. I have not advanced their species much yet, but I am just letting nature take its course. I read a few books in Utopia's library a long time ago that suggested that breeds of bees not found in nature could be created. I will start setting out an area for it. Now then, welcome back to another episode of A Druid's Tale. And Nemsun, as always, in the Magic Farm 3 modpack. I've just finished doing all my chores. I've replanted all the seedlings, all of them, all the way down. I've moved the other seedlings around a little bit and made sure that the metal ones that I want next are growing. But that's all stuff you see before. I'm just now maintaining it, doing it steadily. I've altered the farm over there, the sandwich farm, to increase the sugar cane and decrease the fruit because there was a slight unbalancing going on over there. And also on the wheat farm, I have added a little bit extra, like an extra block around the outside to adding a little bit more wheat because we were running slow on the bread. I've got loads of sandwiches, like stacks and stacks of sandwiches and loads of cups of tea, plenty of food, but I was getting a backlog in certain areas. So I wanted to clear the backlog and figure out how to get it all set up nice. And also, if you check on the map, I have cleared out this area over here and done quite a bit of pumpkin farming and planted lots of jack-o'-lanterns around the fields here. Not quite managed to finish it off yet, but I'm hoping to do some more over the bee side of things today. The reason I cut off here was because of the water side here, and also there's kind of a drop-off point around here as well. So I decided to keep it to that section there. But you'll go and see that in a bit anyway, because we'll be going over there in a bit and doing some stuff. I want to build a little house for the bees, maybe a little structure somewhere within here. I don't know how I'm going to do it exactly yet, but I know just by clearing out all this space that I don't actually need all this space. It'll look awesome when I'm finished, hopefully, but I don't need all the space. The way we left things, and thank you very much for your comments in the description, down below of last episode. The three methods that we looked at for automating bees last episode are here, and they are working well. Let me just explain through what they each do. This one has a reinforced servo. A reinforced servo has the ignore use metadata, use MBT. So I've been able to set that to ignore MBT. Also, the added advantage is that combs don't get sucked out because the opaque, well, the thermal dynamics of it, I don't need to actually set any whitelist because it will try and suck out anything that can fit into a slot. So, as you can see here, look, there's 18 drones in there, which means this cycling has happened quite a lot. And we've got three honeycombs, which means it's not the best, but it has been cycling through and making honey. The stringy comb and the brimstone moth we'll get to later. I got them through different means, but I just put them in there for storage. So, overall, right, this item duct system seems to work beautifully. The reinforced servo is only really required if I wanted to whitelist stuff. I could disable the use metadata or MBT data. And I think as we found out over here, that the ignores metadata didn't make any difference because metadata is more the damage and durability of an item, like how much it's got on it, whereas the MBT data is kind of the differences between another item metadata, MBT data. I don't know. You probably know how to describe it better than I do, but that's it. And this system has been running as well fairly smoothly, and we're up to 20 cycles through here. Not bad, not bad at all. And we've got 8 of the mundane combs. So that system set up there works. This system set up here works. And this sets up here with the refined relocation, putting any princess and any drone inside that chest. has also worked. We've got 8 combs. All of the princesses and drones have been dropped into there, filtered through the hopper and down into the apiary, and that's had a few cycles as well, as you can see. Obviously, daylight and rain and stuff stop the bees from producing, but all three methods are working. So what I was looking at next, right? The next thing I was looking at is, what do I want to see in my fields of beekeeping, right? If all of these three can be equally set up, this one has 2 input outputs and could be set up exactly the same as this, but we're always going to have something coming up above it. This one in particular has quite a lot above it. It has 2 things above it and those things to make it all work. So this setup here is not going to work for me because it doesn't look like a beehive, does it, anymore? It doesn't look like a beehive anymore. So that's no good. And these ones, okay, but I've got pipes going into them. In both cases, pipes going into them. I would like to have no pipes on show. So let me just sleep. Got my bed over it. Let's make it day again quickly. This is what I've been doing to keep the bees as active as possible, is trying to sleep away the night so that they're always active during the days, which is very good. The setup that I've been looking at is this. Yeah, this is a refined relocation block extender. Now, I've got a couple more here and an apiary. Let me just show you what I think the end result would look like. That's quite a way down. Yep. Let's have it. Let me do it this way, actually. Let me pop. That there. That there. Get rid of that and that. That's it. Go down here and put the block extender underneath it. Okay, and then another block extender underneath that, and then, well, this would then be where I deal with all the stuff underneath it. So I'll just fill that in for now. Okay, so you get the idea. That is what I fancy having the bees looking like. It almost looks like it's on a kind of a plinth or a table or something to hold the apiary up in the air slightly. And these block extenders, you may or may not know that they work like the block itself is lower down. So for this example here, look, this is the block extender that's above ground with the apiary on top, just the same as that. And the block extender that's below ground has the extra utilities pipes going into it and out of it in the same way as those setups over there, right? So the filters are identical. I just copied the filter over and the output is nothing. So it just pulls anything out. And what this proves to me is that it does work because I put a queen in here and it's been cycling through until now. It's got 8 drones, which means that at some point it's been taking the transfer node out of the bottom. And this block extender means it's been taking it out the bottom of the apiary. And then it's been pushing it back into the side, which with this block extender means it's been pushing it into the side of the apiary. But with this system, with the block extenders from refined relocation, I can make the place look much better. And I can take the produce down into the depths below the nice looking thing and actually deal with it and process it and all that kind of stuff. I think I'm probably going to need a kind of a setup with some refined relocation as well to bring produce where I want it and send things where I need it, because these sorting connectors are fairly cheap. They cost me a little bit of gold, which I've still got plenty of, and they also instantly transfer items from one place to another. So as soon as I take some of these out, for instance, as soon as I put them in, they instantly are back up there, back into there, and filtering down into here. Yeah. So they're instant. Whereas these pipes, they have to search for a location to put things. So whenever something's in there, they have to search for a location. One zip across isn't very long, I know, but it's still like that extra little tick, and there's potential chance for something to get blocked in there and all that kind of stuff. And the other thing with these, I believe these still have an item travelling through them, but it doesn't take the items until it needs them somewhere, which may also be a little problem. What I want to see happening with this setup here is that as things go into a chest, that chest is a refined relocation chest, which then puts the items exactly where I want them to go, exactly where I need them to be. So in the case of this guy here, I would potentially have a refined relocation chest. Let's see. A refined relocation chest. Let's think about it. Let's have it right there. So in front of each of the bees would be a chest. That chest would receive bees of a certain type. So in this case, this is unusual princess or unusual drone. So anything that says unusual drone or unusual princess, oh, we see it all in action, working very quickly as well. The unusual princess or unusual drone would go into this chest here. So if anywhere in the system an unusual princess or an unusual drone came in, it would get deposited into this chest. And that's a simple right click, put the custom filter on, the same as I did with this that setup over here. And then also the combs. Now, we have the sorting barrels. I don't actually have any sorting barrels on me, but they're an upgrade of the better barrels that I've got on me. The sorting barrels off the back of these, like I've got in my entire sorting system down there, put the combs in all the right barrels instantly as well, thanks to being sorted connected. Sorting connected. Yeah, that one. So while in a similar sort of way to this, right, it gets a chest and it pulls down into it, I'm basically taking that chest and making it this chest over here, or this chest next to it here. But it's next to this setup instead. And that should give me the opportunity just to put that straight into the block. The block extender, which goes into here. So things go in and out of this chest here and through the entire network connector setup and everything, all sorted. Hopefully, I might need to take this one block lower and put it underneath a trapdoor. Speaking of trapdoors, that leads us very nicely onto... Hello, villagers. How are you doing? I've been looking at these villagers, right? I brought them over here and I put them into their holes with trapdoors over so that mobs, if they had any potential chance of getting mobs, they were not going to allow it. And I've done the first trade with both of them. This one wanted oak wood, which is actual wood, not planks. It looks kind of planky and it's got no render of wood, but it is just oak wood logs. Are these? Yeah, oak wood logs. But the render on it looks a bit odd. But it is just 24 oak wood, and that gives us an apiary, which is an awesome little trade, quite nice indeed, because that saves us the thing about doing the seed oil and all that kind of stuff. And then the second trade that it opened up was, give me a princess and I'll give you an emerald. I wish it was the other way around. I give you an emerald, you give me a princess, then you'd be more useful. This guy over here, 2 wheat for some stringy comb. That's where I got my stringy comb from, that's in the chest over there. I did a couple of trades with him with some wheat just to see what was next. And look at that, another princess for emerald thing. So both of them are technically useless to me at the minute until I start wanting to dispose of my princesses. Yes. But it does mean that I've got plenty of options for buying with wood the apiaries that I'm going to use over there. This extender, however, is slightly more expensive. Let me just show you how much more expensive it is. Not by vast amounts, but it is by amounts. We've got an enderpearl per 4, right? So 4, let's say we use 4 per apiary. Just a for instance, 4 per apiary. And that means that we're going to need 1 enderpearl and 4 iron per apiary. Not so bad, because I've got quite a stack of enderpearls right now. Obsidian was the one thing that I was worried about. Glass pane's not so bad either. But the obsidian, I do have a factory over there which just needed me to retop the lava to start stocking up on the obsidian again. So it should be okay to go there. And over at the area over here, I would like to build some stuff. I would like to get this section over here done. And he didn't get much of a fly on, did he? Get down here. Rick, come on. That's it. Up we go. There we go. And wait, here we go. Yeah, so I solved the problem of the big tree by making the big tree part of the thing. It's actually buried under there. I didn't dig it out. I just put soil around it and let the grass grow around it. I don't think it looks too bad, actually. It looks okay, especially as this is going to be the orchard anyway. Figured I'll just leave it there. When I've got an axe capable of doing it, I'll probably go off and find another one or trim this one up slightly and that kind of stuff. Because I'll need this great wood for when I'm playing around with Thorncraft. But in general, this area is all leveled out and set. I've still got more pumpkin lights to place in, and I've obviously got to harvest all these fruits and start setting them up with other trees and all that. But there are some really cool ones here, actually. The paper and the maple syrup. The maple syrup ones, you just click it and you get an actual maple syrup in a jar. When it's highlighted like that, it gets a maple syrup, which went over here in this case. And this one is paper bark. So as you click it, you get paper bark. And you can use bone meal on these. So I did use the last of my bone meal, and you bone meal that paper bark, and it actually reveals paper. I don't know at the minute if it needs the leaves or not. I don't know if it needs the leaves to do it. If it doesn't need the leaves, then I can kind of just have one block for maple syrup, one block of this log, and just bone meal it when I need it, or just set it up so I can come along and get some maple syrup when I want it. But that's bad about all of these fruits and all that are all growing nicely now. We're all getting on with it. Pecans and all this kind of stuff. We've got quite a lot of variety of fruits here. But they're not grown out onto all of the leaves yet. And I've got a trick with blood magic to do something with that. You may have seen it in my Agrarian Skies 2 video series. But that is for another day. I'm just going to keep working on spreading those out as and when. But I fancy having a little build of something over here. Something for the beekeepers and the bee villagers, as it were. Yeah, something for the beekeepers, the bee villagers to have as a home over in this section. Let's get back before the baddies come out to play. I think there's quite a few spawning already. Yep, there is. Okay, I'll get back over here and get to sleep if I can. I think I can, yeah, I think I can. Yep, boom, sleeping. Yeah, so that's what I want to get set up. And generally, that's the setup that I'm looking at. This kind of viewpoint. Maybe this chest goes one lower. And I want to do it over there. And then I want to build a central sort of structure for all of the produce to go to. So I might just sort of outline that and get a few of these set up, just so that I've got some bees cycling through while I'm building over there. I do want to leave a bit of space for the bigger multi-block structure of these as well. I'm basically just using these to get the honeycombs in order to make the honey, in order to process the first few types of bee. But we'll get to that as well soon. First of all, I need to get something set up over there with all the resources I've now got at my disposal. Okay, well, I think I'm ready to show you what I'm up to again. I've been busy preparing the area, trying to plan it out a little bit while waiting for some resources to grow and things. I've done a few bits and pieces here and there just to get things going. And I'm now about ready to set up at least the first one, I think. Set the first one out. Yep, there we go. Awesome. Plenty of that. And I will swap that around later on. And yes, I've got an area planned out. And it looks okay. I think next episode we need to have a building episode to do... that's not even an empty one. Is that an empty one? Yes, it is. Yeah, we're going to have a building episode next episode to try and figure things out. Oh, 24, that's not too bad. And pop that away. And is there anything else? No. Iron ingots, I don't need to take the iron ingots with me. There's something wrong with this. I don't know what's up with this. This sorting connector is not connected for some reason. I don't know why this chest is... Well, this chest isn't working, why it isn't sorting. I must have disconnected it somehow. Somewhere, some shape or form. I don't know how I did it though. But anyway, I'll look at that later. See if I can figure something out. Small problemos. Nothing to worry about for you guys. And somehow I managed to get two ricks. I don't know how I managed to get two ricks. I flew over with Rick and then appears another one. And I really don't know how I've managed to do that. He's got 14 in his saddlebags. And he's got 15 in a redstone ink. So he's the one that I've been using. And this Rick just seems to have duplicated himself in this area, in this chunk. Maybe when I went over that way and... Oh, yeah, that way. And unloaded the chunk, I somehow duplicated him. Maybe. Because he had 14 feathers in him, in his saddlebags. And he had 14 feathers in him. And while I was over there doing some digging stuff, I put the redstone ore and one of the feathers that he drops, just like that, inside of him. And then when I flew him back, I actually thought this was spellcheck. But now I've realised it's two ricks. And where is spellcheck? I don't know. Where? Oh, man, it's weird, isn't it, sometimes? But anyway, let's fly it over there. I've got an extra rick. Who else needs a rick? Eh? Everybody needs an extra rick. An extra rick is always useful. Having two ricks is better than having one, as they say. Oh, wait, hang on. Let's have a look at this. Yeah. So, as you can possibly tell, it's kind of hexagon-like. Yes. Hexagon-like. That's going to be part of the building stage. I was planning out where everything is going to be for the building stage of things. And I'm kind of where I should be right now. It's kind of... Yeah, obviously beehives, hexagons, yeah? So, beehive, hexagons, yeah? A little bit of a gap between each of them, but I haven't necessarily included the little bit of gap between each of them. Just kind of got this overall, like, hive shape. So I'm just sort of hive shaping it. This section here would be duplicated on the other side here. I just haven't done it yet. And so these chunks, these six chunks here... are all going to be filled with buildings, which means I've got two chunks that side, two chunks that side, which are going to be actually something to do with bees and the apiaries. This back one over here, I've set it up with 3x3s, which is the multi-block structure of the next level up of aviary. And I'll be getting around to those eventually and feeding those into the processing area. So these will all feed underneath the ground into the processing area. I'm having the hives, I think, putting out over here in these sections. And I want to leave enough space so that I can also breed trees over by the bees as well. Or maybe I'll have a tree breeding section somewhere over here. But then as you come through the section here, I want this sort of like an open area that still looks like part of the same hive. But this is where the storage is going to be of all the various different things that we're going to be storing. Like, well, actually, it's not going to be like combs, because combs are going to get processed. Then the produce of the combs will get stored in here. The produce from the bees will get stored in here. And that's just simply going to be connected like that and automatically sort itself out. So I need to bring the sorting connectors across this way. Out into this field here and figure out exactly where I want those beehives to go. And I think the first thing I want to do is figure out how much space a bee actually takes up. So I brought over my generator and my centrifuge, and I wanted to centrifuge a couple of these combs and just get a little bit of honey for my Device, where did I leave that? Did I put it in here? Yes, I did. Let's put those in there as well. Let's take my B-Elizer out. I don't need those anymore either, do I? Just put that stuff away in there that I don't need right now. Yep, that'll do. And that sorting connector can go in there. Yep, there we go. You might be wondering why I've got the Mistcraft crystals. Don't worry, I'll show you that as well. Aha, honey. Good. Alright, so bees. Which bees do I want to check out? Let's check out this unusual queen. So, put me honey in, out of the way. Okay, unusual queen. The territory. The territory of a bee is a 9x6x9. So, 6 tall. So, that's probably 3 above and 3 below. Or maybe it's 6 above and none below. I'm not sure. But we'll leave it as a 9x9 area. So I'm giving them a 16... Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to drop you. A 16x16 area over here. And they only actually need a 9x9 area. So how about we get 4 from the outside. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And 1, 2, 3, 4. And then dig a hole. And that would give them a 9x9 on this edge here. And then 1, 2, 3, 4. Counting with Nemsun time. Dig a hole. Or maybe a bit further along. 1, 2, 3, 4. And there's some more that way. Maybe, maybe not. Let's give it 3 rows. Let's give it 3 rows. Some of them may be less effective, but 3 rows kind of looks okay. Yeah, 3 rows will probably look okay. Maybe if I brought them across one more in this direction, instead of going a pure 9x9, I give them an extra bit this direction. That might work even better than my advantage. I don't know if I'm going to be keeping this, but next episode you'll see exactly what I've done, because I'm going to be messing around with it a little bit more. So, apron is there, and then if there's going to still be 4 apart, then I'd be go 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 apart there. And the same over here. So, I'm figuring out how many of everything I want at the moment. And then I can start setting them up. At the start of next episode, I will give you a rundown on the progress that I've made. Not the progress on how many bees I've made, but how I've managed to hook them all up and get them all set up. It's pretty much using the system that we've just kind of discovered over the last 2 episodes that we've practiced and that I've figured out. Using the refined relocation to move all the produce where I want, but using the pipes to and using these block extenders to be able to access them underneath side. Yeah, I got space for some more. I like this kind of layout. This looks good. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I also need to collect some more bees, right? So that's going to be an interesting project as well. Getting some more bees from around the place. But that also ties me in with what I want to finish up with today. Put another one here. And another one here. In the main sort of processing area, I've also got to consider that bees need... other locations. Maybe this way. Maybe. And then I can have a platform that runs here. Yeah, that's an idea. Let's see about here, maybe. Do I want it that big or do I want it smaller? I think I'll probably just have it a 3 wide. There we go. I was thinking of putting some other dimensions that I can go to. Because bees do need different, like, locations that they grow in. And they're environmental types. If we have a look in our gendustry, then these industrial apiaries, which we might get around to playing with eventually, we probably will get around to using them later, they have emulation upgrades, okay, for different places. So a plains emulation upgrade makes the apiary biome be plains, because some bees need plains to live in. There's a winter, which gives the biome of tiger, which bees some bees need tiger, and so on. There's jungle, there's swamp as well somewhere. There's hell, yeah. There's territory upgrades, ocean, and there's also, that's it. I think the sky one, I don't know. Yeah, there's a few. There's a few to choose from anyway. And bees need various different biomes. So of course we're in this nice plains biome, which means that only like the meadows bees and the unusual bees that I've been using over there will actually like it here. And if they're the only ones that actually like it, then I need another couple of biomes to go to. So I was thinking of having, like, if I want to go and visit my bees, then I will head down a corridor and either go through the portal to visit them in the snowy biome, or come out here to the plains biome, or maybe on the opposite side there'll be a desert biome or the plains biome over here, and do the same sort of bee setup over this side as I do over that side. I might even put another one out the back here, or inside, one that's fairly useful, and have some mistcraft portals to take me to other bee sites, where I will eventually be working on tesseracts and things like that to bring the produce back, but I'll just manually go over there, bring them back, and put them into the system, I suppose, for now. But anyway, that is all we've got time for. I've been waffling on about it all and figuring it all out and kind of trying to show you guys exactly what I'm planning without actually getting it all done on camera. So this section over here, we'll try and have a build next episode. We'll try and build something cool next episode, and I'll set up all the automation side of things between now and then, so that we've got at least some functioning beehives. Maybe not all full of bees, but at least they'll be functioning beehives. And then we will build a nice surround around the practicality of it all working. And then from there on, who knows where we go and how we do it. We'll have to get a few more dimensions from Miscraft sorted out, and we'll have to get some automation sorted out in the central area there to try and build ourselves up a stockpile of things and auto-process things. And oh, there's so many options with bees. I'm going to have some fun. And while I'm over here, I'll also be checking on the trees over there. Thank you very much for watching. Tune in next episode. I'll see you again soon for some more Druid's Tale.